Our first reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12 and following. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body are one, though many, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews, Greeks, slaves, or free. We were all made to drink of the one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot could say, "But I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body," that would not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear should say, "Well, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong," that would not make it less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, then where would be hearing? And if the whole body were just an ear, where would be the sense of smell? Yet God arranged the members in the body, each of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it are, we are many parts, yet one body. And then Paul goes on to talk about how the whole thing's held together in 1 Corinthians 13 by love. It's a bit hard to do the reading for our next chapter, which is Nehemiah chapter 3. So what I'll do, if you're listening to this online, if you take your Bible out and have a read through it yourself, there's a lot of names, but really the heart of it is that everyone comes together as one team, each with different roles. We hear about how the high priest and his brothers built up the sheep gate and consecrated. We hear about how the sons of Hasaniah build up the fish gate. We hear in chapter 13 how the valley gate's repaired by a family, even down to the dung gate. We read about in chapter 28 above the horse gate how the priest repaired each to his own house, how Zadok the son of Immer repaired opposite his house, how everyone worked together as a team to repair each part of the walls, the massive beautiful walls that surrounded Jerusalem. Teamwork, different roles, one task, one vision, one goal. As Dave talked about last week, how the plan came together. And we'll look at what that means for us after our next worship song.
Oh,
I've shared it before, but one of my favourite TV shows is Only Fools and Horses with Del Boy Rodney. And this episode had Granda, the guy before Uncle Albert. And perhaps you'll remember it, it's the one with the glass chandelier. And the Del Boy manages to wing his way into a country noble's house and talks himself into cleaning the chandeliers because it'd be a quick way to make money. And so he descends to this country house with the window lean and all the things that he's going to do to clean this chandelier cheap. They send Grand upstairs to unscrew the chandelier, and him and Rodney are underneath it with the dust masking the sheets. They tell Grand, that's it, knock the bolt through so the chandelier comes down. He knocks the bolt through and it's the opposite chandelier and it falls to the ground and smashes. Now that's an example of a plan that did not come together very well. Last week we looked at Nehemiah chapter 2 with Dave, and he talked about how the plan comes together under the power of prayer, and how Nehemiah looked, and we saw in chapter 1 at the situation, he assessed it, he saw what needed to be done, and he committed it to God. And then we see in chapter 2 how he prayed and how he goes to the man with a plan who is the king of all the whole empire under which was ruling at the time. And the king gives him permission to go to Jerusalem with materials, with supplies, with letters to rebuild the walls. And as he arrives, we see there the end of chapter 2 how seeds of opposition start to come, but he, Nehemiah, stirs the people and says, right, rise. In fact, then chapter 2 there, verse 20, the God of heaven will make us prosper, and we, his servants, will rise and build. Rise and build. We're going to do it. There's an old saying that came from the First World War from a chap, and he used to say, praise the Lord, pass the ammunition. And what he meant by that was plan, do, but trust it to God. And we see this in the New Testament too, don't we? We see Jesus in that remarkable parable in Luke's Gospel of the dishonest manager who rewrites the receipts in order to win favour with his friends. And Jesus commends him, what for? His shrewdness, his planning. He doesn't commend the dishonesty, but he commends the shrewdness, the planning. Take each day as it comes, absolutely. Trust the Lord for each day. Get grace in need for each day. But do what John Wesley says, live each day, but plan for 100. And Nehemiah plans. And part of the plan we see here come together in chapter 3 is a beautiful picture of Israel working together, different roles, one people, one goal, one God. And it's a real lesson for us in the church nowadays, because each of us is different. Each of us is unique. We all know the stories and statistics of how every fingerprint is unique, how every snowflake is individually crafted. God makes us individually in his image, which is amazing when you think about it. It's like a stained glass window. Each different part comes together to make up the whole, and the window would not be complete if one bit was missing. And we see here in Nehemiah how everyone is charged with a section to rebuild the wall. And they clear the rubble, they build up the stones, and they build the wall at their part. But it needed teamwork. As they were doing it their part, they had to join up with everyone else. It's like when the French and the British built the Channel Tunnel. Both started in their areas. The British started their side, the French at their side, and they met in the middle. But it took teamwork to make sure the tunnels didn't pass by each other in the channel. They joined up. Teamwork together for a vision and a goal. Here in Nehemiah, look at the list of people. There's priests. The only ones who get singled out really for disapprovals in verse 5 there, the Tekoites are praised, but their nobles wouldn't stoop to serve their Lord, which is a shame. That's how they're remembered in history, for the ones who sat on the sidelines and did nothing. But the high priests, the rulers of the district, their brothers, servants, all of them come together to serve one goal. There's a story told of, JFK was visiting NASA. And as he was walking up with the eyes, he came to the cleaner. And he asked the cleaner what she did there, and she said, I helped put a man on the moon. And she was absolutely right. Even though she was cleaning the floors with her task, she kept the floors clean and safe so folk could walk about, so that folk could use the NASA building. She was part of a team with a vision to come together. And each of us, if you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ for our salvation, if we come to him as Saviour and Lord, say, I repent of my sins, I trust you, I want to follow you. Each of us has a role to play in the body of Christ. We heard that reading there, the first one I did from 1 Corinthians 12, where Paul's writing to the Corinthian church. And he says to each believer there, you have a part to play. He does quite a comical scene. He sort of has us imagine the human body, the fighting and squabbling amongst itself like a confederation of warring tribes. And I know we get to a certain age where our body does do things that we don't want it to do, and the legs ache in ways we don't want them to ache, and the arms spasm in ways we don't want them to spasm, and hair falls out and all that. And sometimes it does seem like our body's a warring tribe. But Paul does this image. He says, you know, imagine the nose start fighting with the eyes. He says, well, I'm not an eye, so I'm leaving this joint. That's not the way it works. Each of us are made up of trillions of billions of cells. Each has a role to play. We need eyes to see, but we need ears to hear. We need a nose to smell. We need feet to move. We're many members, each with a unique part to play towards the whole. And so it is with the body of Christ. We all can't be pastors. We all can't be deacons. We all can't be prophets. We all can't be evangelists. We all can't be apostles. But we can be what God has made us to be. We can serve where God has called us to serve. And in the great machinery of God's beautiful, gracious providence, we play our role. Nehemiah was God's man for God's hour in Jerusalem to rebuild the walls. The guys who rebuilt the Dung Gate were God's people in God's time and God's hour with their gifts to rebuild the Dung Gate. And we see this all through God's word. Remember the scene in Exodus where Exodus, you know, the first half is exciting. It's full of action. The people are brought out of Egypt. There's plagues. There's fighting with Pharaoh. Then we come to that middle part and there's talk of tapestries and weaving and stuff. And there's many reasons for that in Exodus, primarily to show us how holy God is and how we'd approach him with great awe. But also how each one is given a unique gift to bring the whole thing together. Tapestries made of many threads, but pull one thread out and the whole thing's ruined. And this is important for us as a church as we build, rebuild. We need to assess the situation, chapter one, see what's happening around the world within us with the COVID situation and the task of evangelism. If you take our statistics, our church is less than 1% of the East Newark. That's a lot of folk who need to hear the good news. Chapter 2, we pray. We pray earnestly to God. We cry to God for wisdom, for strength, for power, because that's where it comes from our God. We pray for the Holy Spirit to gift us. And when the Holy Spirit gifts us, chapter 3, we see how we're to come together as one body, one people, with one vision to see our Lord glorified, to love him and love our neighbours, ourselves. So we say at Coastline, we want Jesus to be the heart of our church and our church to be the heart of our community. And how each of us needs to find and discern our role to play in that. Not being jealous of somebody else's role, not trying to fill somebody else's shoes, but doing what God has called us to do. Each of us is made unique. Now I know we've heard this so many times that we kind of go passive to, you know, God's got a plan for your life and all that. It's true. It is true. David died and served the purposes of God in his generation. We're called to serve the purpose of God in our generation. You, in our fellowship, and you listening to this, have a unique gift of God has called you to bless your family, your workplace, your community, your area, your church. As you start fulfilling your role that God has given you to do, you see how the Holy Spirit brings along folk alongside you, and together you see what is done to the glory of God. When I preached the first sermon, I mentioned Winston Churchill, and we rightly remember Churchill as the key figure of the Second World War. But I'm reading a lovely book at the minute. It's called Working with Winston, and it's written by a lady who went around and interviewed all of Churchill's secretaries, and he couldn't have done half of what he did without those ladies helping him, the team. And he did thank them and he did give them credit. It's just history, unfortunately, but he was part of a team, and each had their role to play, and together they did something great. Friends, each of us has a role to play in Coastline Community Church. And you know, get out the Bible said, Paul says, each of us has a role. Even the parts that seem dishonourable. Even if you're hard yourself and run yourself down, if you're saved by God's grace, you're a child of God and you have a purpose that he will fulfil through you. You let him. Don't let your pride get in the way. Pride has two forms. It's either folk who are full of themselves or folk who think they're the worst in the world that God can't possibly touch. And that's pride too. He wants to use you. He wants you to be part of his body. Many members, many gifts coming together for one vision, one goal, one Lord. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. I pray what was of me would fall to the wayside, and what is coming from you would speak to hearts today. Lord, we want your people to be stirred up to face the task unfinished, making Jesus known to everyone in love and power and deed. The gospel, the good news, our salvation poured out in word and deed. We have so much work to do. And I thank you that we each have individual gifts to serve you. Each have individual gifts of providence to be at such a time for such a place to be used by you. So open hearts to be used by you. Take away pride, take away self-abasement, and help us to humbly follow you. And for anyone who's listening to this day who doesn't know you, help them to be captured by the vision you have to see this world renewed to the glory of God, to see lives transformed and hope given and souls saved. May their souls and their hearts and their minds be saved this day for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Great.